on this particular journey as Aisha and the Prophet were at the back. Everybody had gone ahead, and the Prophet said to Aisha, "Aisha, let me give you a race." And Aisha radiallahu ta'ala in the beginning, she was very, very young with a light body. So she beat the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So upon some time later, Aisha radiallahu anha was again with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in a journey, and the Prophet said, "Okay, Aisha, let's have a rematch. Let's have another race." And this time the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam raced faster and beat her. And he said, "Oh Aisha, this is to make up for last year." Once the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was asked, "Ya Rasulullah, ayyun nasi ahabbu ilayk? Who is the person that you love the most from all the people?" And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Aisha." Some ulama go to the extent of saying that more than half the deen, almost half the deen, has been reported by all other sahaba, and half deen only by Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. But Mullah Bakir Majlisi has written after this ayat on page 879 of volume 2 Hayatul Qulub, they are saying these ayats were revealed to reveal the kufr na'uzu billah of Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. Ummul Mu'mineen, the mother of the believers, the woman who will be with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Jannah, the woman loved by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Shias, they say, when Imam Mahdi comes, he will raise her from the grave and lash her now. My dear brothers and respected elders, all praises for Allah who blessed us, made us in the ummah of his beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Every aspect of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam's life, his personality is so special and unique. His name is special, the place where he was born is special, his companions are special, his sharia is special, his deen is special, where he lived is special, where he died is special, his companions are special, and similarly his wives are also special. Allah says in the Quran in Surah Al-Ahzab, "Ya nisa an-nabiy lastunna ka ahadin minan nisa." The wives, the women who were chosen to be around the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and with whom the beloved Prophet of Allah shared his life. Allah says, "You are not like ordinary women. You are not like any other woman of the world." Just as Allah chose the people, all the people around the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, "اختارهم الله لصحبة نبيه ولإقامة دينه." The best people in this ummah, kanu afdal hadhihi al-ummah, were the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ulaika ashabu Muhammad, ikhtarahumullahu lisuhbati nabiyihi wa liqamati dinihi. Allah chose them to be in the company of his beloved Prophet. So what about the women who were close to the Prophet, and especially, mashallah, his wives? They were not like ordinary women. Allah chose them specially to be the wives of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and Allah has referred to them as the mothers of the believers. Allah says, "An-nabiyyu awla bil mu'minina min anfusihim," and the Prophet is closer to the people, to believers, than even themselves. In other words, Muslims and true believers give more importance to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and love him more than what they love themselves. And unless and until a person loves the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam more than what he even loves himself, he can never truly taste the sweetness of real iman. So to love Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam more than what one loves his parents, his children, and everybody around him. And Allah says then, "Wa azwajuhu ummahatuhum," and then his wives are their mothers. So it's very important for us to recognize the status of the women whom Allah honored and blessed and chose to be the wives of the beloved Prophet of Allah. And the wife of a person is one of the most important people around him. Obviously a mother is a mother, but a person spends the initial part of his life with his mother, but as he grows up and becomes independent, has a family of his own, then the rest of the life is usually spent mostly with one's wife. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, similarly, he spent a very small part of his initial life with his mother Amina, but the later part of his life, after he got married, initially it was a Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha at the age of 25. And then, subhanAllah, she lived with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam for 25 years. And then once she died, then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam married other women. And in one hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he explained that any woman that the Prophet married, or any man that the Prophet married his daughters to, he did so with Allah's will and wahi from Allah. All aspects of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's life are divine and chosen by Allah. Whatever the Prophet used to speak, وَمَا يَنْتِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَىٰ. Whatever the Prophet spoke, unlike most people, we speak whatever comes to our mind and our heart, good or bad. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to speak as and when Allah used to inspire him. So the people around the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam were divinely destined. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was chosen by Allah to be and destined to be his friend and very close companion, and to live with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and then to die and be buried next to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he's resting with the Prophet till the day of Qiyamah, and shall rise with the Prophet, be with him on the pond and beyond, in Jannat for eternity. Whether it upsets or hurts anybody, that's up to them. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has made it clear. And some of the most important people around a Prophet, around any person, are his wives. And Allah has compared or regarded women as hunna libasul lakum wa antum libasul lahunna. They are your garments, they are your libas, they are your dress. And a dress is close to a person. A dress, mashallah, you know, when if anything, any even dust falls on your clothes, what do? Just let it be? No, you try and just, you know, brush it away. Hunna libasul lakum wa antum libasul lahunna. They are your garments and you are their garments. So similarly, the wives of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they were like garments for Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Prophet himself was like a garment to them. Hunna libasul lakum wa antum libasul lahunna. And so if anybody throws any dust on the wives of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as though he is throwing rubbish upon the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And anybody who honors the wives of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as though he is clearly and truly honoring and respecting Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And if anybody, Allah forbid, if any person should dishonor or disgrace or humiliate anybody's wife, you can imagine how they feel. Let alone dishonor or disgrace somebody's wife. If anybody looks at your wife with a bad eye, you can imagine how you feel. You know, people, they could do anything, you know, and to protect the honor of their wives. And similarly, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you can imagine how hurt he would feel if anybody said anything wrong or bad about his wives. And hence Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said to the Muslims that you should regard the wives of the beloved Prophet of Allah as your mothers. Just as we would not tolerate any disrespect to our wives, similarly most decent people will not tolerate any disrespect to their mothers. And your mother and my mother are considered to be mothers. Subhanallah, just because in the society environment, the house in which a person grows up, he sees that he's encouraged as he's growing up. If you have elder brothers and sisters and they call the mother, mother, so a small child automatically grows up calling that elderly woman in that house mother. But the first child, he's encouraged to call that person mother by the father or auntie or even by the mother herself. She might be his mother, she might not be his mother. In many families, people adopt children. And those children, when they are adopted, especially at a tender age, then they grow up addressing and calling that woman in that house who shows them love and feeds them and clothes them and cleans them. And Marsha looks after all aspects of their lives. They end up calling her mother. But sometimes, you know, as reality is, she might not be their real mother. But people, they appreciate the love that a woman gives them and helps to bring them up by giving them respect and giving them love and showing them the appreciation and addressing them as mothers. And we call our mothers mothers because we have seen other people calling her mother, hence we get used to calling them mothers. And but as I was saying in Juma Salat as well, Allah forbid if anybody should go home and be rude to his mother, which no Muslim should ever do. Allah says in the Quran, وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُ إِلَّا إِيَّاهُ وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. Allah has ordained that you should worship no one but Him, Allah, and you should show immense kindness towards your parents, especially the mother. Once a Sahabi came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and he said, Ya Rasulullah, who is most deserving of my respect and my service? The Prophet said, your mother. He said, and then your mother, and then your mother. And then on the fourth occasion, he said, your father. So the woman who deserves your most love, respect, obedience is your mother. But should anybody go home and say to his mother, you are not my mother? That is very bad, very sinful, very bad. May Allah never bring such a day in anybody's life. He will be sinful, he will be a bad person, but that won't make him a kafir. But if anybody says, Aisha is not my mother, Hafsa is not my mother, Ummu Habiba is not my mother, Zainab or any of the other wives of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam are not my mothers, then in light of the command given by Allah, because he is rejecting what Allah is saying, then that person will become a kafir. He will become a disbeliever. He will become a murtad. Why? Because he's denying directly what Allah has said. Allah is saying she is your mother. His wives are your mothers. But if anybody, Allah forbid, any Muslim should turn around and say, any of the wives of the beloved Prophet of Allah are not my mothers, then that person will undoubtedly become a kafir. And if anybody shows any disrespect, ordinary woman, when she dies, after the lapse of her iddat, she is allowed to marry any person of her choice. She can marry anyone. Anyone can propose to her. And if she accepts, then they can marry her. But Allah has forbidden the Muslims from marrying or even thinking about proposing to any of the wives of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah says, "Wala an tankihu azwajahu min ba'dihi abada." Don't you dare ever even think about marrying any of the wives of Rasulullah, because they are your mothers. How can you possibly think about marrying your own mother? But obviously, the Prophet's wives are not our biological mothers, they are our spiritual mothers. They are our spiritual mothers. And in terms of our iman, you know, we have to give them the same respect that we give, even more respect than we give our real and biological mothers. But in this time and age, many people don't understand the status and the importance and the reverence that is fitting for the wives of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Obviously, among the Prophet's wives, as Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha was the first, and she married the Prophet when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was young, 25. And she lived with the Prophet for 25 years. And then she died, she passed away, she left this world when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was 50 and she was almost 65 years old. And Allah blessed her. As long as she remained alive, she was the Prophet's only wife. And she was the Prophet's first wife. And then all of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's children, with the exception of Ibrahim, were through her. Allah blessed the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam with four daughters through Hazrat Khadija: Zainab, Ruqayya, Umm Kulthum, and finally Fatima radiallahu anha. Ulama, they say Allah did also give the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and bless him with two or three sons, but they all passed away at a tender age. One of them was named Qasim. Hence the kuniyat of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was Abu al-Qasim. Some say the Prophet had another son, his name was Tayyib, some say Abdullah, some say Tahir as well. And these are different names which have been mentioned in the books of Seerah. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had four daughters, and they all grew up, and they married. As Zainab radiallahu anha, she married her cousin As ibn Rabi, and Ruqayya and Umm Kulthum were initially engaged to two sons of Abu Lahab. And when Surah Abu Lahab was revealed, then he told his sons to cut off this relationship and to call their marriage off, and which they did. And then Ruqayya and Umm Kulthum radiallahu ta'ala anhuma were married to Hazrat Usman. Then Fatima radiallahu ta'ala anha was married to Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu. After the death of Hazrat Fatima, and she left behind young daughters, and one of the Muslim women, she came up and she asked the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and she said, Ya Rasulullah, you appear to be worried And you obviously miss Khadija. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, yes. She used to look after all the affairs of the house, looking after the children. It's not easy. And so she suggested, why don't you marry again? And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, who will marry me? Who should I marry? And she suggested, well, if you want someone elderly, then there's a Sauda. And if you want someone young, then who better than the daughter of your most, your closest friend, Abu Bakr. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and she said, if you want, I can propose on your behalf. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam agreed and said, yes, women are better for such tasks. So she went and she proposed for the Sauda radiallahu ta'ala anha. And her father was old and blind, and he agreed if the Sauda agreed, and the Sauda radiallahu ta'ala anha agreed, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam went to their house, and the marriage was performed. And when proposal was made for the Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, Hazrat Abu Bakr had initially offered or agreed to give his daughter to Jubair bin Mut'am bin Adi. And he was one of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's staunch enemies in the beginning. And when the Sahabiya, when she came to Abu Bakr and proposed on behalf of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Hazrat Abu Bakr said, I have never ever broken my promise with anyone, and I have given my word for Aisha to Jubair. But he said, let me see what happens. So he went to Jubair's parents and he said, we have agreed for the nikah and the marriage of our children. So what do you think? And Mut'am bin Adi, he looked at his wife, Jubair's mother, in other words, to see what she says. And his mother said, well, we fear if our son gets married to your daughter, because Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu was famous as the companion of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He was the first man to have become Muslim. And Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, unlike other people, did not hide his Islam. His Islam was very special. Although Islam of all people who embraced Islam in the beginning was special, but Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, when he embraced Islam, he went out, he didn't keep Islam to himself, he went out giving da'wah and brought other people to Islam. He was a wealthy man, and as a result of having become Muslim, he used to spend upon other needy people, especially those slaves who were tortured and persecuted, like Bilal radiallahu ta'ala anhu and others, and he set them free. He bought them and set them free. And Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he is the only man who accepted Islam without any hesitation. And people at the time recognized Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu to be the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam's right-hand man right from the beginning. And so Jubair's mother, she exclaimed that we fear if our son marries your daughter, then he will become a Sabi. Sabi meaning he will abandon the deen of his forefathers and become, like you could say in modern terms, atheist. Someone who rejects, you know, the faith of their ancestors and becomes a disbeliever in their eyes. And Hazrat Abu Bakr, and he looked at Jubair's father and he sort of approved what his wife was saying. So from this, Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu realized that they no longer want their son to marry my daughter. And so he went home and gave consent for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Nikah was performed, but they did not live together for a number of years after that. Some ulama have said this happened in the 10th year of Nubuwwat, 3 to 4 years before Hijrah. And some people, they says Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha at the time was only 6 years old. This is what the opinion of the majority of the scholars. Other scholars, in light of other evidence, have other opinion. And they say she was 8, 9 or even perhaps 10 years old. But the generally accepted opinion is that she was around 6 years old. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not take her as his wife and start living with her straight away. He carried on living with her. The Sauda, after 3-4 years, Hijrah took place. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam migrated from Makkah to Medina. And then after some time, some say after the Battle of Badr, a further 1.5 years passed before Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha actually came to live with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And before even the Prophet's nikah had taken place, Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam, he brought to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam a handkerchief or a scarf upon which the picture of Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha was presented to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, that she will soon be your wife. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he was he didn't know how to go about, or he was anxious about how to proceed to propose for Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, and he in his mind was satisfied that if Allah Rabbul Alameen wants the Prophet to marry Hazrat Aisha, then Allah will cause events to unfold which will result in the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam marrying her, and that is what happened. And then after Hijrah, Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she came to live with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and she is the only wife who came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam unmarried or not having been a widow. Hazrat Khadija radiallahu ta'ala anha was a widow. Some other wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam were divorcees, and mostly they were widows. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then after Aisha, married women like Hafsa, Umm Salma, Umm Habiba, and they were all widows. Zainab bint Jahsh radiallahu ta'ala anha, she was a divorcee. She was married to Zayd, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's adopted son, and husband and wife never got along. And one day, Hazrat Zayd radiallahu ta'ala anhu, having been upset by Hazrat Zainab, he divorced her and then came and said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "Ya Rasulullah, I have divorced her." And that was destined to happen. And Allah revealed verses in the Quran, "Inna zawajnakaha," that I have married you to Zainab. And so Hazrat Zainab radiallahu ta'ala anha used to be proud over the rest of the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam with the fact that Allah performed her nikah in the heavens. Allah had similarly destined Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha to be the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's wife. And when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam migrated from Makkah to Medina, initially he was married with a Sauda. Then Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha came to live with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So at that stage, it was only Hazrat Sauda and Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. After some time, the Prophet married Hazrat Hafsa, and then Umm Salma radiallahu ta'ala anha, then Umm Habiba, and then others. And so the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then obviously his time was shared out. But in the beginning, it was only Hazrat Sauda and then Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. And then when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam married other women, eventually, altogether the Prophet had 11 wives. Two of them passed away in the Prophet's company, in the Prophet's presence, Hazrat Khadija and Zainab bint Khuzaimah. The Prophet had two wives by the name of Zainab. One was Zainab bint Jahsh, who was the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's cousin as well, who was initially married to Hazrat Zayd, and she was the Prophet's father's sister's daughter. And there was another Zainab, her name was Zainab bint Khuzaimah. She also passed away in the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's presence. So in the later days of the Prophet's life, he had 9 wives altogether. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam initially used to give them all equal time. And then as a Sauda radiallahu ta'ala anha, she offered her turn to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that the Prophet could spend her turn with Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha as well. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to spend his time with 8 of his wives with the permission of Hazrat Sauda radiallahu ta'ala anha. And he used to spend one night in 7 with the other wives, and one night in 8 with the other wives, and 2 with Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. And Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, when she came into the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's marriage at a tender age, or started living with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, many Western scholars are critical of the fact that look, the Prophet married a young girl. But they forget themselves that when supposedly Mary, or Maryam alayhi salatu wasalam, when Joseph married her as well, she was also about 10, 11 years old. And it is stated, Christian scholars, they say that when Maryam alayhi salam gave birth to Hazrat Isa alayhi salatu wasalam, she was barely 12 years old. So when she was 12 years old and she gave birth to Hazrat Isa alayhi salam, and when she was married to Joseph and he approached her, he found her to be with a child. So Joseph, he wanted to consummate his marriage according to Christian beliefs. We don't believe that Maryam alayhi salam was married to Joseph. Islamic scholars don't approve of that. But Isa alayhi salatu wasalam was born to Maryam alayhi salam without any male intervention. But Christian scholars believe that God came to this world and he took on the form of Jesus, and he became Mary's child, as it were. So Mary carried him. So when Jesus was born, it was supposed to be God in human form. So God came to this world
or showed himself through the birth canal of a 12-year-old girl. Through the birth canal of a 12-year-old girl, na'uzubillah min zalik. And so before they criticize Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, they should check their own beliefs. What they believe as well. They believe that Jesus was born to Maryam, to Mary, around the fact that she was a very young girl, barely 11, 12 years old herself. But the reason why Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha came to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam's life at a tender age, ulama have explained, because Allah blessed her and chose her, and Allah wanted to honor her, to give her the opportunity to learn from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam at a tender age, and learn in a very thorough manner, because children are very observant. And when they see something, happening, they absorb it and they learn very quickly. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam had many aspects of his life. One was obviously he was a Nabi of Allah, Rasul of Allah, and a teacher. But even Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, like most people, used to spend a lot of his time with his family. And most people spend at least half of their life with the families. Most people, even devoted, committed Muslims, mashallah, who've done hajj, who pay zakat, who fast in the month of Ramadan, who even pray five times a day, even if they come to the masjid to pray five times a day, how many hours do they spend in the masjid? How many hours do they spend at work? But even in spite of working, coming to the masjid, they would spend almost half of their life with their wives. This is why nikah is considered to be half of our deen. إِذَا تَزَوَّجَ الْعَبْدُ فَقَدْ إِسْتَكْمَلَ نِصْفَ الْإِيمَانِ. This is almost half of our iman. And this is almost half of our deen. And just as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, خَيْرُكُمْ مَنْ تَعَلَّمَ الْقُرْآنَ وَعَلَّمَ. The best amongst you are those who learn and teach Quran. Similarly, the Prophet said, خَيْرُكُمْ لِأَهْلِهِ. The best amongst you are those who are good with their family members. So how one should treat his family, and the love we should give them, the tolerance and mashallah appreciation, the attention one ought to give his family. This was to be passed on behalf of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam to the ummah. Just as how the Prophet prayed is important, how the Prophet did hajj is important, how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam fasted is important. Similarly, how the Prophet lived at home, how he would spend his days was narrated by Sahaba. How he spent his nights, how he would come home, how he would eat, how he would sleep, how he would do all these things that most people do at home. And that needed to be passed on as well, so that people can emulate themselves and follow in the example of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So Allah Rabbul Alameen gave this honor specially to Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. Although there were other wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as well, but because they had come from different backgrounds, they were more mature and they were older. So the way Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha picked up things, and most people, although the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam married as Aisha when he was 50 plus, and she didn't come to live with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam until he was almost 55, 56 years old. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allah blesses all prophets with extra strength. Allah gives them the strength Allah will give the people in Jannah. So in spite of reaching that age, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, very few, even when the Prophet left this world at the age of 63, some many years later, 8-9 years later, there were only about 20 odd hair in the beard, in the noble beard of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which were white. And most of his beard was still sort of pitch, his natural color. And so the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in spite of his mature years, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wasn't like ordinary old men. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to treat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha and give her special attention. And the way the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam treated her, when we look at the books of Seerah and we look to the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is as most young people treat their wives. Many times the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would be sitting, he would eat with Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha in the same pot, and he would drink from the same place that Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha would drink, and he would, mashallah, he would appreciate the fact that she wants to play, and she, you know, she was, mashallah, you know, playful. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in one journey, she was traveling with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and it was the Prophet's practice, that whenever he went on a journey, he would take one of his wives with him. And the way he would do that, he would sort of take their name from a drawer. Whosoever's name came out of the drawer, he would take her. And once Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she was with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam would normally walk at the back, so that he can keep pace at the slowest rate. And all the other Sahaba would be in front, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam would be at the back. And so happened on this particular journey, as Aisha and the Prophet were at the back, everybody had gone ahead, and the Prophet said to Aisha, "Oh Aisha, let me give you a race." And Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, in the beginning, she was very, very young with a light body. So she beat the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So upon some time later, Aisha radiallahu anha was again with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam in a journey, and the Prophet said, "Okay Aisha, let's have a rematch. Let's have another race." And this time the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam raced faster and beat her. And he said, "Oh Aisha, this is to make up for last year." And once the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was in his house, when there were some people, they were doing some acrobatics on the street, and as Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha wanted to see and observe, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was standing on the door as it were, and as Aisha came from behind, and she stood resting on the shoulder of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam from the back, and you know, just to observe what the people are doing, or the play, etc., in the street. And as long as Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha wanted to observe and watch, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam stood there. He asked Aisha, "Have you had enough?" She said, "No, Ya Rasul, I want to see more." The Prophet stood there. And when she had had enough, then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then he moved as well. And once the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was asked, "Ya Rasulullah, ayyun nasi ahabbu ilayk?" Who is the person that you love the most from all the people? And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Aisha." And everybody was aware that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam loved Aisha so much that when people wanted to give gifts to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and people often sent gifts to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Prophet has encouraged people as well, tahadu, tahabu, give presents to each other. This increases love. Even if a person is rich and he doesn't need what you give him, but even if you give him something, even though it may be a little thing, mashallah, it increases your importance in their eyes. And people, you know, giving gifts to each other, making salam to each other, feeding each other, these are all things, mashallah, which increase love and understanding, mashallah, in society and amongst people. And Allahu Akbar. So this Amr bin As radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, "Ya Rasulullah, who is the person that you loved most amongst the people?" He said, "Aisha." And so much so that people were aware that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam loves Aisha so much, and that people, when they wanted to send the Prophet gifts, they would wait for Aisha's turn. And so that when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would go to her house, they knew he'll be more happy. He looks forward to going to Aisha's house. And so, and when, so they would send a gift, it would bring more happiness, nurun ala nur, to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that he was already happy being in the house of Aisha. On top of that, he's received some gifts as well, some food, some whatever. So it used to give the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam extra pleasure. So Umm Salma radiallahu ta'ala anha, who was also one of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's wives to come into his nikah later on, she complained to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "Ya Rasulullah, we are also your wives. You know, people send you gifts and they wait for Aisha's turn. And so, you know, you can let the people know that they can send you gifts whenever they want. You know, they don't have to wait for Aisha's turn. You know, they can send us, you know, as well." And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to her, "Oh, Miss Salma, don't give me grief with regards to Aisha. Don't talk to me about Aisha. Just leave me alone. Let me be with Aisha as she is." So then people approach as a Fatima, the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the rest of them, because as a Fatima radiallahu ta'ala anha was very dear to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Prophet would never say no to Fatima. In fact, whenever he would go on any journey, he would go and see Fatima right at the end, and mashallah, meet her and greet her. And when he would go to her house, she would stand and then come to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and kiss his forehead. When she would come to the Prophet's house, the Prophet would treat her similarly as well. The Prophet would stand up for her and greet her and treat her well, mashallah. And in one hadith, the Prophet has said that Fatima is part of me. Whosoever keeps her happy keeps me happy. Whosoever makes her angry makes me angry. And Sayyidatu Nisa Ahlil Jannah, she will be the leader of the women in Jannah. And so the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, so other wives of the Prophet, they came to the Fatima to put forward the same proposal, that if anybody wants to give the Prophet any gift, they don't need to wait for Aisha's turn. Wherever the Prophet is, they should send him gifts. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to Fatima, "Oh Fatima, don't you love the person that your father loves? Oh Fatima, don't you like or don't you love the person or the woman that your father loves? In other words, Fatima, you should also love her the way I love her as well." And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, "Fadlu Aishati ala nisa'i ka fadli saridi ala ta'am." One of the favorite dishes of the Arabs is a food called sarid. Sarid is bread which is cooked in the sauce of meat. And a meat, al-lahmu sayyidu ta'am. In one hadith it is stated, you know, the best of the foods, the main food is meat. And meat, it has its own flavor, its own odor, mashallah. And in a food, there are three main things. Obviously the taste, then nutrition, and it should have nice smell as well. If the food doesn't smell good, you know, sometimes you walk by restaurant, mashallah, even if you are not hungry, you know, it makes your mouth water. And then good food, mashallah, has good nutritional value as well. And similarly, in a woman, there are three main things. One is beauty, other is intelligence, and third is obedience. The most important thing for a woman with regards to her responsibility, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in one hadith has said, the most important right on a man is that of his mother, and the most important right on a woman is that of her husband. And whosoever amongst the women is prays five times a day, fasts in the month of Ramadan, looks after her honor and chastity, and remains obedient to her husband, then she will be able to enter Jannah through any gate she so desires. So for a woman to be beautiful, for a woman to be intelligent, and for a woman to be obedient as well. And all these things as though they were part of Aisha's personality. As Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, being the daughter of Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and her mother's name was Umm Ruman. As Abu Bakr had a number of wives as well. One of his wives was Umm Ruman. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, Umm Ruman, the Prophet praised her beauty and said that she is as though she is a hoor from Jannah. So you can imagine if her mother was so beautiful, then she must have also been beautiful as well. But from the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Umm Salma radiallahu ta'ala anha and Safiya radiallahu ta'ala anha, they were regarded as being the most beautiful. But Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, in her own way, she was exceptional. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, "Fadlu Aishati ala nisa'i ka fadli saridi ala ta'am." The virtue of Aisha over all other women is like that of sarid over all other foods. Sarid is a complete food. Smells good, tastes good, mashallah, has good nutritional value. Similarly, Aisha has all these wonderful qualities. She was also beautiful. She was also obedient. She was also very intelligent as well. This is why among the ahadith narrated by Sahaba, she is amongst those who has narrated the most hadith. The most hadith have been narrated by Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And then after Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala anhu, there's Abdullah bin Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, there's Jabir radiallahu ta'ala anhu, there is Anas radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and then after them, it is as Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. She is narrated more than 2,210 ahadith from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Although other sahaba have narrated more ahadith, but there are reasons. Because these sahaba, they used to mix with the people. They would be in the masjid, people would come to them to learn and they would teach them. And these sahaba would travel around and get to people. Whereas Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, being a woman, one of the wives of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and so people were not her mahrams. And there were certain people that she had specially, this is why whenever a child was born in Medina, has Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she would encourage people to send them to her sister so that she would breastfeed them so that they could become mahrams for her. So that they could come and meet her and they could learn from her directly. But in spite of all that, she was a woman and she did not generally travel to places freely to teach people. Only those people who were fortunate enough to come to Rasulullah, to her house to teach to be taught, she would teach them. And ulama have stated more than a quarter of the deen has been reported by Aisha radiallahu ta'ala. All the other sahaba, some ulama go to the extent of saying that more than half the deen, almost half the deen has been reported by all other sahaba, and half deen only by Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, like I said, he loved her very dearly, to the extent, subhanallah, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam left this world, it was Aisha radiallahu, he was with her, and towards the later part of his life, when he could not travel around and give all his wives their turns, he sought permission from them and retired to be with Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. And eventually it was in her house and in her lap that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam left this world. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was buried buried in her hujra, as it were. And while other wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had their hujras around the masjid as well, but at a distance, as Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she had her hujra totally adjacent next to the masjid. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has explained, ma baina bayti wa mimbari rawdatun min riyadil jannah, the place between my mimbar and my house, implying the house of Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, that is a garden from the gardens of paradise. And where people go now and they see the grave of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has been buried, and that is where as Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha used to live initially. And in that small hujra, there was space only for a few graves. And when Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu passed away, he requested to be buried next to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he was. When Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu was martyred, he also sought permission from Hazrat Aisha to be buried there. As Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she said, I had wanted to be buried there myself, but Umar is more worthy of being buried next to his friend, so I give him preference over myself. And then when later on she passed away in the 57th year after Hijrah, she lived for 46 years after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and then she requested to be buried in Baqi with the other wives of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his daughters, and the rest of the Muslims. Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he performed her janaza, and then she was laid to rest by some of her nephews and by close members of her family, and she passed away in the 57th year after Hijrah. In between, she had also, there was one opportunity after the shahadat of Usman radiallahu ta'ala anhu, when some of the supporters of Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu had laid a siege around Hazrat Usman's house, which led to his shahadat. And people seeing that people who had martyred Hazrat Usman were supposed supporters of Hazrat Ali, as Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha at the time had gone to Hajj, and then Talha and Zubayr radiallahu ta'ala anhuma, they followed her and informed her of the situation. So instead of returning from Makkah to Medina, she proceeded to Basra. And Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he thought that she is proceeded towards Basra in order to gather support and to revolt against me. He pursued her, and then there was an extensive dialogue in which many things were discussed, and eventually it was agreed that they will go their separate ways. But the rebels and the hypocrites who were inciting these differences between the among the Muslims, before Hazrat Ali and Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha went their separate ways in the darkness of the night, they caused a battle to start. And a battle started, which is referred to as the Battle of the Jamal, the Battle of the Camel, in which Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, when she saw that the battle is raging between the two groups, she came to quieten and to calm the situation. People thought from her side that she's coming to encourage them to fight on more. And then Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha's younger brother Muhammad bin Abi Bakr, who was with Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he came in and he chopped off the legs of the camel, because of which the camel came to rest. And Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha was brought down, and the battle was contained. So that became known as the Battle of the Camel. And as a result of which, the Shias, they hold extensive grudge against Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. And they, astaghfirullah, such a woman who was close to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who came into the Prophet's life with Allah's will, and who was loved by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam so much, and that the Prophet didn't tolerate any disrespect to her.
even from his other wives. And the Prophet ﷺ used to show so much love for her. And people, subhanAllah, this is a book which is called Hayatul Qulub, written by Mullah Baqir Majlisi. And if you go on the Wikipedia and you type in Mullah Baqir Majlisi, it will tell you that he was one of the most powerful and influential Shiite scholars of all time. He's written this book. He's written many books. And one of those books is this, which is known as Hayatul Qulub. And in this book, he has criticized Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha extensively. And in Surah Al-Hujurat, there is an ayat. يَا أَيُّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِنْ جَاءَكُمْ فَاسِقٌ بِنَبَأٍ فَتَبَيَّنُوا أَنْ تُصِيبُوا قَوْمًا بِجَهَالَةٍ فَتُصْبِحُوا عَلَى مَا فَعَلْتُمْ نَادِمِينَ. In which Allah says, when any bad person brings you any news, then investigate. Don't just, you know, just believe any rumor which is spread in society. Investigate to see. Otherwise, if you start spreading false rumors, then you will regret afterwards. And but Mullah Baqir Majlisi has written after this ayat on page 879 of volume 2, Hayatul Qulub, to Khudawand Alam ne ayat qazaf nazil ki, jin ko ahl sunnat kehte hain ke Aisha ke haq mein nazil hui, wo Aisha ke kufr aur nifaq ke izhar ke liye Khuda ne bheji hai. Nauzubillah. They are saying these ayats were revealed to reveal the kufr, nauzubillah, of Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. So these Shiite scholars, nauzubillah, they regard as Aisha one of the women closest to the Prophet, and the Prophet used to love so dearly, and he wanted to die in her lap, in her house. How dare they assign such things to this very special and pious woman. On another page, page 900, he goes on to say, because Shias believe that the 12th Imam, they have a concept which is known as Imamat. This is Ali is the first Imam, then Hassan second, and Hussein third. Then Imamat got transferred into the progeny of Hazrat Hussein, and then altogether there were 12 Imams. And the 12th Imam vanished in a cave called Surre Manra. And before the end of time, he will return, and when he returns, at his hands, Islam will spread throughout the world. And in here, on page 900, he's saying, Mullah Baqir Majlisi in volume 2 of Hayatul Qulub says, Ali bin Ibrahim ne riwayat ki hai ki unki ek khiyanat Aisha ka Talha wa Zubair ke saath Amirul Mu'mineen se jang ke liye Basra jana tha. Aur Hazrat Sahibul Amr in Shia terminology is the title of the 12th Imam or Imam Mahdi. Aur Sahibul Amr Aisha ko bi hukm khuda zinda karenge aur is khiyanat ke sabab had jari karenge. Nauzubillah. What they are saying, Imam Mahdi, when he comes with Allah's will, he will raise Aisha, make her alive again from her grave, and then lash her for fighting against Hazrat Ali radiallahu ta'ala. Nauzubillah min thalik. Ummul Mu'mineen, the mother of the believers, the woman who will be with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Jannah, the woman loved by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Shias, they say, when Imam Mahdi comes, he will raise her from the grave and lash her, na'udhubillah min zalik. Ali radiallahu ta'ala in Nahjul Balagha, which is a collection of the khutbats of Ali radiallahu ta'ala, which has been reported after the Battle of Jamal, he said to the people, walaha ba'du hurmatuha al-ula, although what has happened, but just as she was our mother before, and the respect we used to give her, and the love and the reverence, now again she deserves the same respect as she had before. وَلَهَا بَعْدُ حُرْمَتُهَا الْأُولَى. Even after the battle with Hazrat Ali, Hazrat Ali used to still regard her as his mother, Ummul Mu'mineen. But the Shia scholars, in spite of their supposed love for Hazrat Ali, they abandoned their backs to Hazrat Ali, and these are sort of the slandering which they lay against Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. And they say, and on page 923, he goes on to say, Mullah Baqir Majlisi, Ayashi ne bisanid mu'tabar, Hazrat Imam Muhammad Baqir se riwayat kiya ki jab janab rasool khuda sallallahu alaihi wasallam ne duniya se rehlat farmayi, char ashkhas, Ali bin Abi Talib, Miqdad, Salman aur Abu Zar ke siwa sab murtad ho gaye. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam left this world, other than four people,
Ali bin Abi Talib, Miqdad, Salman, Abu Zar, everybody else became a murtad, na'uzu billah. Which includes Aisha and Hafsa and all the other Sahaba as well, na'uzu billah. So how is that possibly possible that when subhanallah, there was another famous incident, obviously the incident of the slandering of Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, in which Allah revealed many ayats in the Quran in Surah An-Nur, showing Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha's innocence, that she was innocent from the slandering and this accusation what the munafiqs were laying. This, because this is in itself is a very detailed account, a very very detailed story, and requires a complete lecture in itself. And we have talked about this issue on many previous occasions, but subhanallah, Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam also asked as Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu at this time as well, what he thought about the situation. And Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu did not say anything disrespectful to Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, but Shias and their books are filled with kufr. With regards to the Prophet's family, with regards to the companions, and if you go on the internet, on the YouTube especially, you put scandal, Aisha killing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, na'uzu billah. There's so much in their books, and they believe that Aisha and Hafsa actually conspired to poison the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, na'uzu billah min dhalik. While Aisha and Hafsa radiallahu ta'ala anha were one of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam dearest wives, and Allah had promised the Prophet, Wallahu yasimuka minan nas. Many a times when people try to poison the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allah saved the Prophet. And if Allah saved the Prophet from the poison of the Jews and the other enemies, was Allah going to leave the Prophet on the mercy of Aisha and Hafsa to be poisoned by them? Where is the sense of any people gone? How they have no sense, they can lay such accusation. You can imagine. When an ordinary person, if somebody says something inappropriate with regards to their wives, how hurt he is. You can imagine how hurt the Prophet ﷺ must feel when people lay baseless accusation against the women that the Prophet ﷺ used to love. May Allah have mercy upon her and save us from the fitna of such evil people. As the Prophet ﷺ in one hadith has reported, إِذَا رَأَيْتُمُ الَّذِينَ يَسُبُّونَ أَصْحَابِي. When you see people, they are cursing my companions, they are swearing at my companions. فَقُولُوا لَعْنَةُ اللَّهِ عَلَى شَرِّكُمْ. And then say, may Allah's curse be upon your evil. Such people who curse the companions, the wives of Rasulullah ﷺ, they are nothing, but they have nothing but evil in their hearts. And the beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has commanded us to say, oh Allah, curse the evil of such people who curse your companion, the companions of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. May Allah grant us love for Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, love for his companions. May Allah fill our hearts with love and respect for the wives of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and may Allah give them the fitting reward that they deserve.
الله الرحمن الرحيم النبي وأولى بالمؤمنين من أنفسهم وأزواجه أمهاتهم يا نساء النبي لستن كأحد من النساء وقال الله عز وجل الطيبات للطيبين والطيبون للطيبات سبحان ربك رب العزة ما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد وبارك وسلم. My dear brothers and respected elders, we begin in the name of Allah and thank Him and praise Him and glorify Him. We seek His forgiveness and we ask Allah to send His infinite mercy upon His beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to enlighten our hearts with His love and love for His beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and to guide us all to the right path so that we can all live like Muslims, die like Muslims, and rise like Muslims on the day of Qiyamah. My dear brothers, it is a part of our iman, rather a condition of our iman, that we love Allah and we love His Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam more than what we love anybody else. وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَشَدُّ حُبَّا لِلَّهِ. Those who believe, they love Allah profusely. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى أكون أحب إليه من والده وولده والناس أجمعين. No one can become a believer unless and until he loves me, implying Rasulullah, more than what he loves himself, his parents, his children, and all the people of the world. Love for Rasulullah means also to love whatever was beloved to Rasulullah. As they say in English, a friend of your friend is also a friend. A dost ka dost bhi dost hota hai. A friend of your friend is a friend, and someone who's an enemy of your friend is also your enemy. So think, people who are close and dear to Rasulullah should also be dear to us. Love for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam means to love anything and everything that has anything to do with Rasulullah. To love his name, to hold his name in high esteem, to love the place where he lived, to love the place where he's buried, to love his masjid, to love his companions, to love his family as well. Any member of his family, Allahu Akbar, who were fortunate enough, blessed enough, chosen to share their lives with the beloved Prophet of Allah, they can't be ordinary people. Many people think, you know, family is yes, daughters, grandsons, they are also part of one's family. But the family of a person initially begins not with a son, but with the wife. Wives of Rasulullah are all part of his family. Everywhere in the world, throughout the history of mankind, wives have been regarded and are regarded as one's family. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's family, it incorporates all his wives, not just Khadija radiallahu anha, not just Fatima radiallahu anha, and Hassan and Hussein and Ali radiallahu anhu ajma'in. They are part of his family, but along with them and more importantly are all his wives. And these wives are all part and parcel of Rasulullah's family. His wives are so special. Allah says in the Quran, Ya Nisa al-Nabi, lastunna ka ahadim minan nisa. Oh, you wives of my Prophet, you are not like ordinary women. Just as Rasulullah isn't ordinary, Rasulullah is special. Everything about Rasulullah is special. His wives are similarly extremely special. And his wives are so special, as Qari Sahib was recited the ayat from Quran in Surah Al-Ahzab 21st Sipara. Azwajuhu ummahatuhum. The wives of Rasulullah are the mothers of the ummah, the mothers of all the believers. We are required, we've been commanded and taught to respect our mothers. The mothers who gave us birth, the mothers who feed us, look after us, help to bring us up, we should give them the utmost respect and love. After Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the most important right upon any person is the right of his parents, his mother and father. But suppose a person goes home and is unfortunate enough to say to his mother, oh mother, I don't care, you are not my mother anymore. May Allah never ever bring such a day in anybody's life, especially the lives of Muslims. May Allah grant us all, especially our youth, to understand the importance and right and respect and love of mothers. Al-Jannatu tahta aqdami al-ummahat. Jannat isn't just gained through ibadat, through hajj and umrah and through other means. Service to your parents is another sure way of attaining Jannat and paradise. Your father similarly, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, is like the door of Jannat. You can keep it open by keeping your father happy, or you can shut it upon yourself by making your father angry. But suppose somebody goes home and says to his mother, I don't care, you are not my mother anymore. I don't take you as my mother. You are not my mother. Very sinful, very shameful. But that won't make him a kafir. Very sinful. But it won't make a person kafir. But if anybody says, Aisha is not my mother, Hafsa is not my mother, Ummi Habiba is not my mother, then that person will become a kafir, because Allah is saying she is your mother. She might be your mother, she might not be your mother. In many families, people adopt children. And when they take them up, then mashallah, the people, uncles, aunties and other cousins, they encourage that young child growing up, opening his eyes to address this woman as a mother. She might be your mother, she might not be your mother. And but if anybody says Aisha is not my mother, Hafsa is not my mother, Habiba is not my mother, Maimuna, Safiya, Zainab bint Jash, and others are not any one of them, the ones who are lucky enough to share their lives with the beloved Prophet of Allah, and Allah is saying they are your mothers, if anybody denies their motherhood and shows disrespect to them, that person will become a kafir, because Allah is saying they are your mothers. Wives are a very sensitive issue. People are very sensitive because of their wives. Some people, they even, you know, subhanAllah, we're living in very difficult times, times of fitan and fasad. The beloved Prophet of Allah has prophesied regarding these times. Ata'a ar-rajulu imra'atahu wa aqqa ummahu wa adna sadiqahu wa aqsa abah. Man will be very obedient to his wife, being disrespectful to his mother, confide and be close to his friends and distance himself from his father. Many people, they take on serious problems in their families. They even break off their ties with their mothers because of their wives. Give the mother respect she deserves. Give your wife the respect and love and attention she deserves. And try and keep everything in a balance. But most people can't. And many a people end up even breaking ties with their own parents, brothers and sisters, because of their wives. Wives are a very sensitive issue. When you even pray somebody's wife, people can take that as an offense as well. If you say to somebody, Yaar, aapki biwi badi khubsurat hai. You know, your wife is very pretty. How is he gonna take it? What do you think he'll say? Yeah, man, you wanna look at her? In many cultures, especially if you go in Pathan, Afghanistan, in these places, you pray somebody's wife, that will be probably the last thing you ever say in your life. Be your wife, you know, so it's nice. He's going, who the hell are you to say anything about my wife? She's my wife. Go home to your wife. Now leave my wife alone. She's my wife. Many a times you say something nice about somebody's wife, they'll take that as an offense as well. But if anybody insults somebody's wife, people don't even like their own brothers, even their own mothers and fathers, saying something inappropriate, indecent with regards to their wives. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Sayyidul Awwaleen wal Akhireen, Rahmatul Lil Alameen, Khatamun Nabiyeen. And the Prophet said, I am the most sensitive amongst all the people. I have the most ghairat from all the people of the world. Rasulullah was very sensitive because of his wives as well. When the Prophet ﷺ came to Medina, he migrated from Makkah to Medina. As long as he was in Makkah, when he was young, he married Hazrat Khadija radiallahu anha. And as long as Hazrat Khadija remained alive, he didn't get another wife. But when she passed away, Rasulullah married a number of wives. Initially Hazrat Sauda, then Hazrat Aisha, then Hazrat Hafsa, Umm Salma, and others. And when Rasulullah came and settled in Medina, around Masjid al-Nabwi, there were different hujras. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam didn't have houses. Rasulullah had hujras. Allah has revealed a whole surah in the Quran entitled Surah al-Hujrat. The hujras of the wives of Rasulullah were close by the masjid. And Sahaba Ridwanullah alayhim ajma'in occasionally used to send Rasulullah presents. Some food, some fruit, some dates. Someone they used to slaughter an animal, some meat, etc., some milk. As a present for Rasulullah, to make him happy that somebody has sent Rasulullah something. And it says in narration, Sahaba would wait for the day Rasulullah was going to visit the house of Aisha, and Sahaba would send those presents on those days. They would realize Rasulullah is happy that day, happier than other days, and then to make him even more happy was a good opportunity. Other wives of Rasulullah, they realized this practice and they tried to send out a message. Look, we are also wives of Rasulullah. Rasulullah comes and visits us as well. He spends the nights with us. We need to entertain him as well. And so you can send whatever you want for Rasulullah to all of our houses. We will give it to Rasulullah, present it to Rasulullah as presents from you. But Sahaba carried on waiting for the day of Aisha. And then the Azwaj Mutahara, the rest of them, they gathered around Hazrat Fatima. Fatima, look, we want We want to ask you a favor, if you can be kind enough, put in a word to Rasulullah, to put in a word to the people for us, that everybody, you know, they're all your followers, they love you, they want to give you presents, and we are your wives, so you don't they don't have to wait for you to go to Aisha's house. They should send you whatever they want to, whenever they want. So Hazrat Fatima radiallahu anha, she agreed, and she came to Rasulullah and she said, "Ya Rasulullah, I've got a small request. Request, if you don't mind." And the Prophet said, "Go on." And she said, "Well, this is what, you know, the other wives are saying." The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to Hazrat Fatima, "Fatima, don't say anything to me when it comes to Aisha. Just, you know, with regards to Aisha, don't you love the woman that your father loves? Are you not happy with the woman your father is happy with? And when it comes to Aisha, look, don't say anything to me." Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was so sensitive to Aisha radiyallahu ta'ala anha. The Prophet said, "Fadlu Aishati ala nisaik, fadli tharidi ala ta'am." The status of Aisha over all other women is like that of tharid over all other foods. It's a very special dish amongst the Arabs. You know, in a food, when you present it with something, if it doesn't look nice, if it doesn't smell nice, if it doesn't taste nice, whatever it is, it'll probably be medicine, not food. So nice food, smells nice, looks nice, tastes nice, mashallah. And a woman similarly, Allahu Akbar. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam compared as Aisha, she was much more noble, much superior than any comparison to any food. But in a woman, people like beauty, people like, mashallah, a bit of intelligence as well. And people like devotion, sincerity, piety, humility. Aisha radiallahu anha, she had all these qualities. Her mother was Umme Ruman. And she, Umme Ruman, was the wife of Abu Bakr. She was so pretty. Rasulullah once said, "If anybody wants to see a hoor of Jannat in this world, it's Umme Ruman." The wife of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. And as Aisha, like they say, daughters usually go after their mothers. Aisha radiallahu anha similarly was a replica of her mother. And then to mash, the intelligence Allah gave her, the piety Allah gave her, the understanding, the knowledge that Allah had given her. Many a women, subhanallah, many a women remain obedient to their husbands. They support their husbands, give them assurance and comfort in hard times. But many women, they share the burden of their husbands. They take a role, an active role in the responsibilities of their husbands. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, in one hadith, he says, "Innama bu'ithtu mu'alliman." I've been sent as a teacher. I've been sent as a teacher to teach people deen, to teach them to live the life that Allah wants them to live. Our deen isn't just about praying and hajj and umrah and other things. They are very, everything is important in its own way and has its own status and position. And jihad and other things, mashallah. But along with these things, our deen is a family deen. Family deen, family affairs are very important in Islam and a very important part of the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So much so, it's almost half of deen. Half of iman, half of our deen. A person spends almost half of his life with his family, especially the wife. Ordinary people at least, half of their life is spent with the wife. Half of their life is spent with the family. During the day you go out and about to work, to study, wherever. But at nights, in the morning, sometime in the day, you spend at home with your family. And especially the wife. And so it's important how you treat her. Allahu Akbar. And as Aisha radiallahu anha, Allah honored her. She came into the Prophet's life when she was young. And lived for over 46 years after Rasulullah passed away, teaching the Ummah that personal aspects of the lives of Muslims. She was a teacher to the Ummah, many prominent Tabi'eens, and many even amongst the Sahaba Ridwanullah alayhim ajma'een. They learned a lot of knowledge and they gained advice and teachings from Aisha radiallahu anha. She represented the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and she taught the personal life of Rasulullah, many of the things he would do at home. The Ummah had an opportunity for many, many years to listen and learn from Aisha radiallahu anha. Unfortunately and sadly, we're living in times of fitan and fasad. Many people have the audacity, they have this hatred for those blessed souls. For a man, usually it's an honor that when he is born, if he's born into a pious family, his father is honorable, learned, pious, special, then people refer to him as MashaAllah Sahib Zada, son of so and so. Because then when he eventually grows up, he gets out and about, he mixes with people, meets and greets them, he passes on that goodness. Women can't do that. Women don't go openly in society. But for any woman as well, it's an honor to be daughter of a special man. And then in the later part of her life, when she grows up, she marries a man. And if he's a special man, then she gains recognition sometime being the wife of a special man. And then sometimes Allah blesses them with children, and then she becomes the mother of a special man. Hazrat Aisha radiallahu anha didn't have children of her own, Allah's wisdom, but she was the daughter of a man so special that after the prophets there was no other man more special than her father Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. Just as no woman gave birth to anyone more handsome and better than Rasulullah. خُلِقْتَ مُبَرَّعًا مِّن كُلِّ عَيْبٍ كَأَنَّكَ قَدْ أَحْسَنُ مِنْكَ لَمْ تَرَقَتْتُ عَيْنًا وَأَجْمَلُ مِنْكَ لَمْ تَلِدِ النِّسَاءُ. No woman gave birth to a man better than Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Similarly, after the prophets, there hasn't been any woman to give birth to a man like Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. And Aisha radiallahu anha, she was his daughter. And when she grew up, she became the wife of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah says in the Quran, At-tayyibatu lit-tayyibin. Good women are for good men. There is no man better than Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So if good women are for good men, obviously only the best will do for the best. If no man, which certainly isn't anyone better than Rasulullah, hence the women Allah chose to share their lives with Rasulullah. What can you say about them? In Quran Allah says, Hunna libasul lakum wa antum libasul lahunna. They are your garments and you are their garments. Before a person marries, in English there is a special word, is a bachelor. They refer to him as a bachelor. In Punjabi they say chada chant. But after you get married, mashallah, you become a family man. You complete. Just as a person who's not wearing any clothes, you might be whatever, but you seem incomplete. Without clothes, you don't go anywhere. You put on the best clothes that you can. When people get married, they want to look their best. They want the best wife for themselves. Allah says, Hunna libasul lakum. They are your garments and you are their garments. In another verse in the Quran, Allah says, Ya ayyuhal ladina amanu, innamal mushrikuna najas. Oh, you believers, mushriks are najas. So if a person's wife is a mushrika, or if a person marries a mushrika woman, or a mu'mina marries a mushrik man, then as though she will be taking on clothes which are najas and impure. If a man, Muslim man, marries a mushrika kafira, as though he's putting on najas, filthy, dirty clothes. Allah has, this is why forbidden. وَلَا تَنْكِهُ الْمُشْرِكَاتِ حَتَّى يُؤْمِنَّ وَلَأَمَةٌ مُؤْمِنَةٌ خَيْرٌ مِّن مُشْرِكَةٍ وَلَوْ أَعْجَبَتْكُمْ. No Muslim man, no believer should marry any woman who is a mushrika. Here the Mufassirin, they say, mushrika implies kafira. A non-believer whose iman isn't sincere and pure. Allah says, don't try marry them until they believe. Even if they seem so pretty, وَلَوْ أَعْجَبَتْكُمْ, even they impress you, you crazy, head over heels about them. But until they believe, don't marry them. And no man in their authority, and no woman should try, وَلَا تُنْكِهُ الْمُشْرِكِينَ حَتَّى يُؤْمِنُوا, وَلَعَبْدٌ مُؤْمِنٌ خَيْرٌ مِّن مُشْرِكٍ وَلَوْ أَعْجَبَكُمْ. No man should try and marry his daughters, or no woman should try and marry a mushrik man until he believes, even though they might seem very good. So if Allah has forbidden the believers and us from marrying any partner who might not be a true believer, do you think Allah will allow Allah will allow a woman who wasn't a sincere and true believer to come into the life of His beloved Prophet? If Allah compares the wives as clothing and says that mushrik people are najas, and will Allah allow His beloved Prophet to be dressed in najasa? What do you think? Can Allah ever tolerate any shirk and najasa around His beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? So when Allah will not allow that, anybody who has any audacity to say anything inappropriate, and when from amongst us doesn't want anyone saying anything inappropriate towards our wives, how do you think Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and do you think he will tolerate anybody saying any nonsense towards his wives? And not just his wives, the woman he loved the most. Umar ibn As radiallahu anhu, he was a special man himself as well. Everybody around Rasulullah was special. He came to Rasulullah, Ya Rasulullah, ayyun nasi habbu ilayk, who do you love the most? Ya Rasulullah, who do you love the most? You know what Rasulullah said? He said, Aisha. He said, minar rijal. What Ya Rasulullah meant was from amongst the people. He said, Abuha, her father. The woman Rasulullah loved the most, the daughter of the man Rasulullah loved the most, people have the audacity. Mullah Baqir Majlisi in Hayatul Qulub has written that when Imam Mahdi will appear, they call him Sahibul Amr, when he will appear, the first thing he will do is go to the grave of Aisha and raise her and then lash her. Anybody in their home, people live together. If anybody says anything indecent towards your wife, people are prepared to cut off ties. Move out of the house. Never come and visit them again. If anybody shows any disrespect towards anybody's wife, you think Rasulullah will tolerate such nonsense? Anybody threatening to show any indecency towards a woman Rasulullah loved the most? Yes, we as believers and Muslims, we love Fatima radiallahu anha, the daughter of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Undoubtedly, Rasulullah said, Sayyidatu nisa'i ahlil jannah. And the greatest woman in paradise is Fatima, and why shouldn't she be daughter of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? You know, a man loves his mother. We all ought to love our mothers. And love for a mother is a different flavor. Like, you know, fruits are sweet, mango has a different sweetness. Melons have a different sweetness. Sugar cane has a different sweetness. They're all sweet flavors and very, very nice flavors in their own way. Similarly, all different loves have different flavors. Love for mother is a different form of love. You can go and say whatever, ma. You know your mother loves you. This is such a love second to none. You have a love for your daughter, mashallah. You know, each time you see your daughter, you pick her up, or when she's young especially, you hug them, you cuddle them, you kiss them. Mashallah, that's a special love in its own way, unique to a daughter. The love for a mother is different, the love for his daughter is different, but the love for a wife is different. The love that a person has for his wife, that confidence, that secret affair between a man and a woman, Allahu Akbar. And the love for Fatima radiallahu anha Rasulullah had, we should have the daughter of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But the love that Rasulullah had for his wives, that was similarly a unique and special love. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam declared that love for Aisha radiallahu anha. There was an incident in the life of Rasulullah. People slandered her. They accused her wrongly, inappropriately, falsely of wrongdoing. There was a time when another prophet of Allah was accused of being inappropriate. Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, Allah raised a young boy to testify in his defense. When Maryam alayhi salatu wasalam, when she was slandered, Allah raised Isa alayhi salam to say something in her defense. When Aisha radiallahu anha was slandered, Allah didn't raise anybody else. Allah himself testified to her defense. Then Allah says in the Quran, وَلَوْلَا إِذْ سَمِعْتُمُوهُ قُلْتُمْ مَا يَكُونُ لَنَا أَن نَتَكَلَّمَ بِهَذَا سُبْحَانَكَ هَذَا بُهْتَانٌ عَظِيمٌ. When you heard these slandering, these lies, these false accusations that they lay against this blessed woman, Allah says, why did you not say all this is rubbish? Rubbish! Anybody who lays any criticisms on Aisha, Allah doesn't want to tolerate it. Allah doesn't tolerate no nonsense. And just as the munafiqs, they were at the forefront of all these accusations. Anybody who lays any accusations against Aisha radiallahu anha, Allah made it clear till the day of Qiyamah, they are nothing but munafiqs. And people will carry on, and they will. This is why Allah revealed it in the Quran, for you to understand. Anybody who slanders Aisha, the woman Rasulullah, the beloved Prophet of Allah, loved the most. If Allah so wanted, Allah could have taken the soul of his beloved Prophet away while Rasulullah was in the lap of Aisha or Ali as well. There were two special occasions when Rasulullah needed a lap, needed something to rest, needed someone to comfort him. One was when he was in the cave during the night journey of migration, and Rasulullah was in Ghar-e-Sawr. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam needed a comforting lap. Allah provided it in the form of the lap of Abu Bakr. When Rasulullah was leaving this world, Allah knew Rasulullah would require a lap to be in the comfort of. Allah chose the lap of the daughter of Abu Bakr to give him comfort. As Aisha radiallahu anha, she says, Jibreel would never come to anybody, any other wife of Rasulullah, when Rasulullah would be there, except when Rasulullah would be with Aisha in their house, and he would be resting with her. She was the only woman even Jibreel would come to his house when he wanted to bring revelation. Allah had so much appreciation of Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha. You might know, why are we doing this international Khatam-e-Nubuwwat mission talking about Aisha? Aisha is a representative of the personality of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Love for Aisha is love for Rasulullah. Respect for Aisha is respect for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Just as if anybody says anything inappropriate, indecent towards your wife, you wouldn't tolerate it. And you think Rasulullah resting in his noble grave would tolerate the rubbish which people are trying to throw at Aisha radiallahu anha? Last year, in September, October, the Shias, and I'll say it openly, clearly, when they have no shame, so why should we beat around the bush? We don't need to beat around the bush. And when they clearly celebrated the death of Aisha on the YouTube. Go and have a look. We're living in times of fitan and fasad, evil and corruption. And no longer, if anybody didn't know, 30, 40 years ago, if you didn't know who Shias were, or any other fitna, Qadianiyat, or Ghair Muqallidiyat, or whatever, it didn't really bother you too much. You minded your own business, and they got along with their business. But now, everything is being bombarded at your doorstep. In your houses, these channels and other things and fitan and fasad. Your children are sitting on the computer. They don't even need to sit on their computer. They carry it in their pockets 24/7. And they're spending time on YouTubes and other things. They are surfacing the internet and they come across this filth. They're slandering the wives of Rasulullah. And we were supposed to have a nishid, but because of shortage of time, it was overlooked. On other occasions, mashallah, when there is a jalsa speech, there is a recitation of Quran and a nasheed. In this filthy program, they sang a nasheed, Aisha finnar. It's on the YouTube. That Aisha, na'uzu billah, is in Jahannam. Allahu Akbar. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. And people are, in many places, you know, we go to, they say, Maulana, please don't talk about controversial issues. Maulana, koi ikhtilafi masla nahi bayan karna apne. This is a controversial issue. This is a part and parcel of your iman. If anybody says anything inappropriate towards your mother, you wouldn't tolerate it. How can you tolerate anything inappropriate towards the mother of the ummah, the daughter of Abu Bakr? Radiallahu anhu, the wife of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. I put out a challenge. If any Shia
in his right frame of mind would dare, I am making dua now. Ya Allah, wherever Aisha is, put me there. Put me there. Allah. Obviously, we don't deserve to be where she is. She'll be in the Most High. But somewhere low down under her feet, Ya Allah, take us all there. Allah. If they have the nerve, they make dua, Ya Allah, wherever Aisha is, put us in the other place. Because we know Aisha is in Jannah. And if anybody hates her, and Allah will not allow such a filthy heart to infest Jannah, which has the hatred of Aisha in his heart. May Allah grant us her love. Love for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And love for the companions of Rasulullah. That is all love for Rasulullah. Wa sallallahu wa sallam ala Sayyidina Muhammad.